When I was working on that small newspaper outside of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, I don't think I ever thought that I would be eventually working for a magazine like National Geographic, having more than a dozen books published, and spending my life traveling around to some of the most interesting places on the planet and photographing some of the most important events of our time. It's been an incredible run. It's been an incredible life, and I just am so thankful that I decided to take this particular journey because it's been so rewarding. To be able to witness the things that I've seen and to be literally on the front line of history has taught me so much. I can't imagine a better way to spend your life than traveling and photographing and just seeing this incredible world that we live in. One of the most important points that I always remind myself when doing a story or being in a location is to look for situations and be involved in things that you have passion, that you care about, stories that have meaning to you. At the end of the day, the pictures that I care about and I think are interesting and successful are pictures and stories that I felt very deeply about and that I cared about. As a young photographer, the first country I went to was India. I immediately fell in love with the culture, the people, the landscape. This was a place, this was an ancient land, ancient traditions, religions, Buddhism, Hinduism, Sikhism, that had gone back for hundreds, in some cases thousands of years. And it had such depth that although I've been back 80 or 90 times, it's a place I've never gotten tired of, and it's a place that you can travel and explore endlessly. One needs passion to do your best work, to be involved in situations that you believe in, that give purpose to your life. My work, my art, my photography is something you never retire from. It's something that you do until your last breath. We just go on because that's our life and that's our passion that energizes us. That's what gives our life meaning and purpose. And you would never want to stop eating or sleeping or breathing, and that's the way I view my work.
It's a pleasure to be here in Milan. I come here often. It's one of my favorite places to come back to. I'd like to thank of all of you for coming and during all this rain. It's a little bit uncomfortable. But I'd like to start off with a couple of thank yous and a couple of acknowledgments. First of all, I'd like to thank the city of Milan. I'd like to thank one of the principal people who's made my exhibitions and much of my work here is Biba Giachetti from Sud-Est 57. Big, always been an inspiration and a help to me and my work here in Italy. We have a one of the great photographers, one of the great magnum photographers, one of the great Italian photographers, one of the great photographers of the world is Fernando Sciana, right here in the front row. Also, Kyle Scott from the American Embassy is here. I'd like to thank him for joining us. So I have this presentation here, and I apologize for not being able to deliver it in my presentation in Italian. I am working on my Italian. It's a little, I'll do it in English. I put this book together looking back at old photographs, the way I work, some of the backstory, some of my process of working. I thought, why not talk a little bit about the places, the situations, the circumstances of, take this picture, for instance. I was actually in the water, too. I wasn't shooting out of a window or whatever. And it was difficult and dirty and disgusting and all that sort of thing. So, but that's, I wanted to talk a little bit about what we do to make the pictures that mean so much to us. This picture is special to me, partly because it ended up on the cover of the magazine, and that the people who make this sewing machine actually found this man and sent him a new sewing machine. So it was kind of a wonderful way to kind of benefit him. People often ask me, why is this man smiling? Because you think he would, he's just lost his shop and his machine is ruined. But as I was getting ready to take the picture, all these people kind of yelled out to him, smile, this guy's taking your picture. So he kind of self-consciously, I think, started to smile, even though I'm sure he was felt like his life was coming to an end. In one of my notebooks, I wrote down some principles and some sort of maxims or guides that I wanted to remember as I was working on this particular story. This is another one of my favorite pictures. This is a poor dog was, you can tell he's desperate to get into the house. He's been locked out, and he's just waiting for the door to open so he can get out of that awful street. But during the monsoon, life goes on, and people just have to deal with it. This is a husband and wife. Man's going to work. The wife is going shopping, and there was no escape from all this water that was, flooded the entire village. The story I did on the monsoon was actually inspired by another wonderful magnum photographer named Brian Brake from New Zealand. And back in like 1961, Brian did this incredible reportage on the monsoon in India, and it ended up being in Life magazine and Parry Match. And as a very young boy, I remember how impressed I was and how I thought, I want to see that. I want to experience that. And 20 years later, I was able, when I became a photographer, I was able to kind of reinvent and go back and kind of reinterpret Brian's story. One of the big challenges, of course, of shooting all this rain is keeping your camera dry, and it was a continual challenge. I had an assistant who would hold the umbrella over my head, but when it started to rain really hard, he would take the umbrella and put it over his own head and leave the camera exposed. So here's one of my principles. It says, surround yourself with good people. This is one of the things I wanted to remember.
One of the most important lessons I've learned while working on stories such as Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, the Gulf War, working in places like Sri Lanka during the Tamil Tigers, was working with the right team, with the right drivers, translators, fixers, because these people really have your life in their hands. A wrong turn, a wrong conversation, a misstep can really be the difference between life and death. These relationships can sometimes last for a whole career. I worked with a driver in Bombay, India, who I ended up taking to Yemen years later because I had such a confidence, we had such a rapport, he had such an innate sense of how to operate in these very difficult situations that we ended up working together in several different countries. Spend the time looking for the right team and then move forward. Working with the wrong people can waste a lot of time and can really put your life and your assignment in jeopardy.
I'm photographing a story in Bombay, India, and I was photographing this very kind of interesting festival, Ganesh, Lord Ganesh. His picture's here. He's an elephant from the waist up, and so people will take this image, this sort of idol, and take it into the sea, and then let it kind of drift away. This is one man. This is actually, you can see this is on the, you know, there's thousands of people. In fact, there's millions of people that take part in this festival. So I was shooting out of a window, and after I made this picture, it's just around sunset, I went down and went into the water to continue to work. And just a little bit after sunset, and these men in the photograph started to attack me. They got my cameras, they held my head underwater, and I thought I was going to be drowned, and all of my cameras were ruined because of the salt water getting into the, and this was the last frame. It got, you know, it's got water damage and whatnot, but you can see some of these guys kind of looking at me, and for some reason, I never could figure out what sort of provoked them, but they sort of pounding on me, and oh my God, I thought I was going to die. But when you talk about surrounding yourself with good people, my assistant who was nearby was able to kind of grab me out of this sort of angry crowd and pull me to safety. I mean, even against the fact that he may have been also beaten up. So I've always felt that in the case of these stories, you really have to work with the best translators, drivers, interpreters. I did another story in Kashmir with, I had one guide who was able to get me inside with the army, with the rebels, with the different militia groups. And this one assistant was able to kind of fix all my appointments and all of my, this is a picture he helped me work on. So another one of my principles was keep your travel days down, and I'll explain that. This is Yemen.
One of the most important principles I've learned in working on major magazine assignments is trying to get to the core, to the point, to the central issue that you're trying to photograph or the story you're trying to tell. Keep your research days down. Stop endlessly ferreting and digging, find the story and then attack it. Because if you have a week to do a story and you spend 5 or 6 days researching, that only leaves you one day to shoot. Better to find the story in the first 2 days and then spend 5 days shooting it. So it's really, you really have to cut to the chase, don't waste time, commit to the story. Too much preparation can lead to procrastination. The main thing is to get out and shoot. You need to keep shooting. That's the main objective.
When I was working in Yemen, I found myself spending days traveling from one area to the next. And I just came to the conclusion that if I didn't stop and just sort of settle on a couple places, that I would spend my whole time just, you know, traveling around. So rather than do that, I thought, I'm going to go to 3 places. I'm going to go to the capital. I'm going to go to a mountain village, and I'm going to go to one village on the seaside, and that's it. I'm not going to go anywhere else. So this was the village that I decided to concentrate on. We got there, and I went to the chief of the village, and I said, I'd like to spend some time here. Perhaps you could suggest a guide here. He said, well, why don't you take my son? He's available. He could work with you. And she said, okay, that's great. Well, this was his son was like 12 years old. But he turned out to be a real asset because his father was the chief. So we went to a wedding with this young fellow. He put on his best suit and his special sunglasses. And it's a tradition in Yemen for men to fire off their guns. So the father had loaned his AK-47 to this little boy. And we got so nervous because as he was kind of firing this gun off, it was bullets were flying all over the place. I thought we were going to be killed. But anyway, this is from the seaside. We spent a week or 10 days, and the area in the desert that we went to was these women were harvesting grass for their animals. And they were completely dressed in black from head to toe and had these very kind of mysterious hats with this very kind of long shape. And I just thought this was really, it looks like a picture from another age, from another time. And as they cut, they even had black gloves on, which was quite astonishing. So another sort of guide principle was I wanted to be part of the conversation, to be part of what was happening in the world, current events. I started traveling when I was 19, and I decided that whatever I do in my life, I want travel to be part of it. But I wanted a purpose. And when I discovered filmmaking and photography, I thought, aha, this is something I can do for the rest of my life. Travel, photograph, document, and tell stories around the world. Take September 11th as an example. I was in New York. We realized this situation was something that we were going to remember and was going to be a landmark in world history. And this was something that absolutely I felt I had to be a part of. I had to do my part. I had to photograph, go down and document what was happening. I've often worked in historical places, places that are in transition, places where their cultures lasted for perhaps 1,000 years, and it's evaporating before our very eyes. I want to document those places
in those situations, because I think it's important for us to have a memory of how we were, how we lived, how life, what life was like on this planet. One of the things that's attracted me to stories like Afghanistan, the Gulf War, Lebanon during its civil war, I wanted to be a witness to these events, these pivotal times in those countries' history. I wanted to be, in a way, part of the conversation, to be there to witness events for myself and to report on these events and to try and tell people, show people what life was like there, share the information, and perhaps affect some kind of change for the better.
I was doing a story in Tibet in September 2001, and on my flight, it was a story on Buddhism, and I had gone around the world, and my last stop was Tibet, and I was there for 2 or 3 weeks, and I was in this kind of very sort of mellow, contemplative mood, and everything was wonderful. I flew back to New York on September the 10th, and got back, I was very jet-lagged, tired. I went, you know, put my luggage and cameras off in the corner, went straight to bed, woke up the next morning, September 11th, and I got a call from somebody who said, you know, look out your window because the World Trade Center's on fire. So I looked out the window, and I it was not only one of the towers, it was both towers. So I immediately ran up on the roof of my building. This is, I live on the top of this building, and I remember thinking, you know, whenever I've gone to cover a conflict, whether it's Iraq or Afghanistan or Lebanon or the Khmer Rouge or whatever, it always involved getting on a plane. And this story was literally photographed from the roof of where I live in my own neighborhood, in the place, you know, where I spend my time when I'm home. So I immediately went down to Ground Zero and spent the entire day shooting whatever I could, and went back again. I couldn't sleep that night. I was awake, and at 3 o'clock in the morning, I walked back down to Ground Zero. And this is actually a picture shot at around 8 o'clock in the morning the next day. And it was just this devastation. Like, it seemed like all of Lower Manhattan had been destroyed. I couldn't see through the smoke, but it just looked like this horrific, incredible devastation everywhere. So I was just, my brain wouldn't process. I just thought this has to be a dream. Anyway, another one of my principles. One of the most important lessons I've learned is some of the great pictures happen along the journey and not necessarily at your destination. As you're driving down the road, you have to be attuned to what's happening, and you have to be looking and searching for possible things to photograph. You can't let good situations and good opportunities pass you by, because that, in the end, may be more interesting than where you're going. Some of my best pictures have happened as I was traveling to a particular place. That destination is long since forgotten, but those pictures along the way end up being memorable. Thank you.
one of the best ways I've always worked is literally walk outside the hotel door and explore and wander and try and get a sense of the mood on the street and just try and get lost in that moment. And suddenly, sort of a magical thing happens where you start seeing pictures, you're relaxed, you're observant, you're in almost a meditative state, and that's when the good pictures come. It's all serendipitous, it's all chance encounters, it's not planned, you're just open, and you're not trying to force the situation, you're just letting it kind of wash over you. And then from that, being open, kind of wonderful things will develop from that mood. If it's good, if you found a good situation, you need to stay with it. It's more about the journey than the destination. Good pictures are often few and far between. Great pictures don't grow on trees. If you recognize something great, don't let it slip away. Go for it immediately.
Okay. This brings me to the Afghan girl picture. Of course, I guess you all know the story. I was just wandering through a refugee camp one morning, 1985, and I just by chance wandered into this girls' school, which was in a tent. And the first thing I saw when I walked in was this incredible little girl with these very intense eyes, and I thought that this is, it's just a powerful face, and this was like the only thing I wanted to do was to make a portrait of her. But I thought, you know what, if I approach her too kind of forcefully, I might scare her off. So I actually ended up photographing some of her schoolmates first to show her that this was okay, this was cool. And after a couple minutes, I asked her if I could take her picture. And at first she was, this is actually the first picture I made of her. She was a bit shy, she put her hands up. And the teacher explained that, this guy is here, this photographer is here because he's telling our story about what's happening in our country and the fact that we've all been pushed out, we've all been forced out of our country, and now we're living in this really terrible refugee camp. So she put her hands down. I kind of moved my camera a little bit to the side, and it was one of those rare moments when, the light and the background, the emotion, everything kind of came into alignment, and it didn't require anything for me. I just pushed the shutter. It was nothing I could do to make it better than it actually was. So this is where it ended up. In fact, there's kind of a funny story. When I got back to the magazine, I had a debate with the picture editor because he thought that this picture was the one that we should present as the cover option, and I thought that the other one was better. He thought that this was too disturbing, and I said, "Well, of course it's disturbing. The situation, there's like 2 million refugees that have, thousands of people have been killed. Yeah, it's disturbing." So we presented these two options to the editor-in-chief, and as soon as he saw that, he decided there's our cover, So the other guy got fired later. But anyway, it's another story. Anyway, we went back There was such an outpouring of interest about this little girl. People wanted to help her, find her, wanted to send her money. It just was this incredible, you know, interest over all these many years. And we decided in 2002 to make a really concerted effort, a really strong effort to try and see if she was still alive and where was she living and, you know, who is she and what's her name. So we went back, and it was like this miracle that out of the, you know, 30 million Afghans, we were able to identify her. Because we had gone to the refugee camp where I photographed her and literally asked hundreds and hundreds of people, you know, we have the picture, do you remember her? You know, and nobody had a clue until we found one man who remembered her brother. So to kind of illustrate this point, I decided to ask her to, if I could photograph her in her traditional burqa, the veil, which she wears every day, and if she would hold a picture of herself as a young girl. And I thought that would be the best way to present this story of finding this young Afghan girl. And this is basically her after we found her with one of her daughters. And, you know, it was such a thrill to actually find out that she was alive, that she had this family, and then we were eager to try and help her, compensate her, you know, obviously pay her for, you know, use of the picture over all those many years. So that's what we did. And we're still, even to this day, even the last week, we keep in constant contact with her and continue to try and, you know, help her in any way we possibly can. Also, another wonderful outcome of this story was there was a girls' school that was started in Kabul for Afghan girls' education. So that was like another wonderful way that this story took another twist and turn, and there was like over $1 million raised for these girls' education. So anyway, that's I think that's the end of my presentation for tonight, but I was hoping that maybe there might be some questions in the audience, and we could do that now if you'd like. Thank you.